Thank you, Rita, for inviting us today and letting us be a part of such a great thing. I was so impressed with the numbers of people that were out at Planned Parenthood this morning. We have a great group of pro-lifers in our community, but I was astounded. I don't know that I've ever seen those kind of numbers, and it's just so inspiring, and I just want to thank everybody who participated in that, and also for all the men that are here. As we talk about the pill kills, it tends to really fall on the shoulders and the lives of the women, and without you here to support us and show us how much you care about us, it would be really that much harder. So I just want to thank all you guys for stepping up.
And thanks to Karen and St. Patrick's, of course, for having us today.
You wrote really small, and I didn't bring my glasses.
You didn't bring your glasses.
Oh, no, this is us.
All right.
This is how we work.
So, you know, as we prepared for this, first of all, I have to say, as we were talking to Rita, it was kind of interesting. She talked about the process of coming up with the pill kills babies, the pill kills the environment, the pill kills women, and that sort of thing. And she's talked about how she had a really hard time figuring out what was going to be next. And I think it's really important to know that she saved the best for last, because wrong use of the word, but this is probably the key issue to all of those, and we'll get into that a little bit and explain what I mean by that. But to start with, a very interesting thing happened as we were preparing for this. Jenny, with her big weekend, decided she better have her hair done. And so share that story with me.
Well, I went the other day to get my hair cut, and the gal that cuts my hair has become, her and her husband have become good friends to Deacon Rick and I. We actually met them at a party of a mutual friend. We got acquainted, and it was really click. We had so much in common. They're very strong in their faith. They're not Catholic, but we really felt like we really had a lot in common, you know, politically and faith. And so I went to get my hair cut like I do occasionally, and we talk about what's going on in our lives. And she asked me, you know, what are you doing this weekend? And I said, well, besides the clinic grand opening, Rick and I are leaving Friday evening to go to Dallas to talk to folks like we do, because we, you know, have our little speaking thing that we do across the country. And she says, oh, really? She says, what are you speaking about this time? And I said, oh, you know, faith, marriage, you know, that kind of thing. And she says, well, do you have like a theme? And I said, well, yeah. You know, I said, it's actually a talk on the pill kills. And she says, really? Well, her daughter is just a brand new OB-GYN. OB-GYN. And I always avoided this subject because of that. Because of knowing her daughter. She's brand new. She's a resident. And I always avoided it because I knew that it would be kind of an odd situation, you know. And she said, really? The pill kills? And I said, well, yeah. And I didn't go into a lot of detail. And she kept asking me, well, what do you mean? And I said, so I told her about the different components of the pill and how it works and how damaging it is. And so she asked me more questions. What kind of scripture do you use for that? And so we talked some more about it. And then she asked about doctors, and I talked about that a little bit. And she got really defensive. She was angry. She was very angry because she thought I was accusing her daughter of being supporting abortion. And I said, well, you know, they don't really teach the doctors that much about that issue. I said, it's not her fault. And I said, the doctors that we know who are very supportive and who are natural family planning only doctors are really set apart from the traditional doctors. I said, they're not welcome into a regular clinic or a regular practice because they don't bring the clientele, they don't bring the financing, the money. And she got really angry, really, really upset. And I felt so bad because she's such a dear friend and we've always had such a good time, and it just got a little bit heated. And
you know, I think what was happening was she was looking at her own life.
Yeah.
You know, not her daughter's, her own life.
Yeah.
And she had come to the conclusion after finding out that the pill has abortifacient properties, that perhaps something was going on in her little world that she wasn't aware of, and things were getting a little close.
Yeah, and that's basically, you know, she did kind of make that point. But then she kind of said, well, it didn't kill my marriage.
Yeah, she mentioned that this week was the pill kills marriage.
Yeah.
You know, and she says, what? It didn't kill my marriage.
Right,
you know,
right.
And I think that's kind of brings us to a real important spot here. You know, it kind of depends on what your definition of marriage is, doesn't it? As to whether or not the pill kills marriages. Because not all marriages fall apart that people are on the pill. But yet, are they getting the most out of their marriages? Are they getting all that God intended for their marriages? And so that's kind of where we'd like to kick off. First of all, to just remind everyone that this isn't a judgmental thing. People don't know. People need to know. Okay, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. But it isn't about judging them. It's about, I was telling Father McCaffrey on the walk back and forth to the car over there that I had read in the Office of Readings, part of the Daily Office, a Pope who had quoted, paraphrased, a Paul line. And what he said was, proclaim the message, and whether wanted or unwanted, insist upon it. Refute error. Correct falsehood. Call to obedience. But always with patience and a desire to teach. Okay? And I just kind of want to remind people here, if you feel any hate welling up inside, if you feel the anger taking over, take a second and just step back from it, because we're all God's children and we're all on different paths, but we're all on the same path. Okay? We were born in the mind of God, and as the psalm says, you know, like a deer longs for running streams, that's what all of us long for, to find our way back to God, the source of our life. That's part of who we are. That's how we were built. And so that's the journey we're all on. And just because someone's off over here somewhere doesn't mean they can't be brought back to the path. Of course, we know where the path lies. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the truth. He's the life. And so one of the things that has touched our heart and actually shown us in so many ways that God is active in our lives, not just our lives, but our lives, is the gift of John Paul II. You know, we were so fortunate to we got really close to him a couple times, but to know him and to have him be our Pope during these times, I think it was a special gift of God showing us that God does care about these issues. You know, John Paul's theology of the body truly does have the power to change everything. And so as we look at this idea of the pill kills marriages, there's really three things we have to look at: the aesthetics of it, the science of it, and the morals of it. Okay, those are the three areas in which the pill attacks marriage. And the first one, I think, really is this theology, this moral issue. With John Paul's teaching of the theology of the body, we learn in Genesis that whole notion of us being made in God's image isn't just that you're made in God's image and I'm made in God's image. You know, the next line in that passage is, in the divine image, he made them male and female. All right? It's the maleness and the femaleness of us coming together, the complementary nature of that maleness and femaleness, that actually shows us who God wants us to see him as. I don't know if I said that quite right. You know, that is God telling us who he is. He built it right into our bodies. Now, we were fortunate in joining NFP Outreach and having Father Paul Richard Hogan as a part of that ministry when we joined. So we got to hear, he's from Minneapolis, and he's an expert, you know, a real good source for understanding theology of the body. And what he taught, first step, was, you know, this whole question of why did God make human beings? You know, he talks about how there's all these angels. Why didn't he just make more angels? You know, and his response to that is, and what he says John Paul's point is that we were made to manifest God's love in a physical way. Now, I've read another book, actually from a gal, I think, that's from Texas, Pat Devlin. Have you ever heard of Pat Devlin?
Yes.
Okay, she's a blind gal. I spent quite a bit of time with her. She, in my recording studio, she was invited up to sing on a project. She's a blind gal, been blind since birth, claims to talk to angels, claims to see them and talk to them. It's an amazing story. Take it with a grain of salt. It's take it or leave it. But the point is, in her book, The Light of Love, she talks about some very interesting conversations she had with the angels. And one of them kind of hinged on that issue. She talks about how the angels aren't necessarily envious, but they really admire this ability of ours to reach out and touch each other. You know, they don't have that capability. And there's a certain beauty to that that they recognize and really admire. And I invite you to read that book. I'm not going to go too far into that, but it's an amazing story. And to hear, for instance, she talks to St. Michael, and she talks to a number of the angels. The Pope's angel, she says. And but anyway, that's another story. So anyway,
invite us back.
Yeah, invite us back. We'll talk about that. So anyway, this whole theology of the body notion, you know, kind of turns on that issue of being made in God's image and how it's in, you know, men and women together were made in His image, and that's why, you know, this the whole point of theology of the body is to show how we were made to love each other, how that came apart when we started using each other. And how we're dealing with that today, okay? And the fact that we are still, in some way or another, using each other. And actually, Jenny has another little story.
I'm the little testimonial girl.
that would probably be smart to get into right now.
Well, you know, as I get into this discussion with lots of different people about contraception and the dangers, you know, mind, body, and spirit, I feel like I really have my own personal story that I can tell them, and they can't deny what I've experienced. I was engaged to be married in 1980.
And not to me.
No, not to Rick. And all I wanted to do was be a wife and a mom. That's all I wanted to do. I wanted to live a very Catholic, holy Catholic sacramental marriage. And so that's what I did. That's what I wanted to do. So as a good little Catholic girl, before she gets married, you know, she starts to plan, you know, how she's going to deal with things. And I knew that natural family planning, even 1980, I knew that that was the teaching of the church, and that's what I wanted to do. I didn't know anything about it. I really didn't know where to go. So the naive little girl that I was, I went to the doctor. And I said, okay, you know, I'm getting married, and this is what I want to do, and can you give me the information I need? And he laughed at me. He made fun of me, and he handed me a prescription. I later found out he was the abortion doctor. I didn't know. And so I left there, and I was really disappointed. I thought, well, that didn't work. Now what am I going to do? You know, we were still in college. My fiance was in college, and so I knew that we were wanting to avoid pregnancy at that point. And when we got married, so I went to the priest who was going to be marrying us, and it was actually a Catholic student center at the local university. And so I sat down with him one on one. I made an appointment. I went in and I said, "Here's the deal. You know, I know that contraception is against church teaching, and but it's a concern for me, so I really want to learn natural family planning. Can you help me?" And he kind of stared at me like, no. And I just thought, well, what do I do? You know, is there anybody? Can you direct me to where I can go? And he's like, I really don't know. And I said, well, what do I do? And he said, follow your conscience. And I walked out of there, and I went and got my pill because I didn't know what to do. And I wanted to be obedient in my marriage, but I knew this wasn't right, but I didn't know what to do. I mean, I was really lost, and I was young and scared. And so,
Not so bright.
Wait, now I'm really bright. Let me tell you.
She's got a lot of pressure.
I am in charge now. But, you know, it hurt my marriage, and I know it hurt my marriage. And as I think back, obviously, I'm not married to him anymore. We had, I was on the pill for a couple years. I couldn't wait to get off of it. I just couldn't wait. So first opportunity, I went off of it. Of course, we had a beautiful girl, little baby girl, and I did not want to go back on it, but I didn't know what to do. And got pregnant 3 months later and had another beautiful baby girl. Of course, that's all I ever wanted to do, so I was in heaven. You know, this is great. At that point, the baby was born, and I could see something going on. And by the time she turned 2 months old, my husband had left me. And I had a 14-month-old baby and a 2-month-old baby girl. And I had he had gone to college. I didn't have an education. And there I was. And I knew in my heart that I had some responsibility. So there I was at 25, a single mom with two little babies, thinking, who's going to want a divorced girl this young with this kind of baggage? Thankfully, mother's prayers, my mother was praying for me to find a man who was Catholic and didn't have baggage, so God gives me an older man. A little immature, so we kind of fit right there in
you
the
know,
middle.
Sometimes we pull out my prom picture with Terry, I won't say her name, but Terry, this beautiful young girl. And then I'll pull out.
I was in third grade.
Then I'll pull out her third grade picture, and I'll think, you know what? I think I'll take the freckled-faced little kid.
But you know, I mean, obviously, you know, and Rick can tell more of his story. But when we met, he wasn't practicing. But it was just like God brought us together. God knew we were supposed to be together. My mother had been praying. We came together through a Marian project that we were both involved in. And we just knew it was right. And so we got married, and right after we got married, we saw in the bulletin natural family planning classes. And Rick says, you know, we need to do this. And
my sister had been on the pill, and it made her absolutely crazy, you know. And I just knew, I don't want to have to deal with that, you know.
He dealt with it anyway. I'm still crazy. But I was scared. I was really, I mean, here I knew this is what I wanted from the beginning. This was what, you know, I always felt guilty about. But here's this new husband who had come back to the church full force, obviously, and comes to me with this natural family planning classes. My first thought in my heart was, well, but what if I get pregnant and he leaves me? That was all I could think about, was what'll I do, you know? But God has really worked through us. And once we took the classes, Rick was so excited. I mean, he was so excited about knowing about
science.
About the science. It totally made him fall in love with the church all over again, because he understood what the church taught and why. And so, you know, one thing led to another, and we ended up teaching it and promoting it and becoming a part of NFP outreach and yada, yada, yada.
I have a question for you, honey.
For me?
Yes. This is just a thought I had.
We didn't practice that.
This is not scripted, okay? What about your husband leaving hurt the most?
What
hurt the most?
The kids.
Tell me about it.
Well, about what he said?
Yeah.
I don't know if I can.
Do it. I've already brought it up. You have to.
The kids were my life. And so when he sat me down and told me he was leaving, I was shocked. I was just, I mean, shocked. But I had a dream the week before that he was leaving me. So it was a little weird. But my first reaction was, well, what about the kids? What about these kids? And he said, well, we could put them up for adoption. What kind of girl marries a man like that? I mean, seriously, you know, that was the worst. That was, at that point, I thought, okay, fine, you know.
And that continued right up to the point where I adopted them. I mean, in the final analysis, he could not wait to get rid of them.
He actually came to me. He never visited them or anything. But he actually sent me a letter at some point when he found out I had been married and asked if my husband would like to adopt the girls, because he was adopting his stepson, which hurt even more because I knew he always wanted boys, you know. But yeah, it was a painful, painful thing all the way up to that point. But God knew all along.
He was rejecting the girls, though. He was rejecting the kids, you know. And I think it's also worthy of note, not to dogpile on him, but it's also worthy of note that he died last year. And the girls...
A very ugly
Yeah, he had cancer.
Death.
And the girls flew down to Phoenix for the first time to really meet him and talk to him.
On their nickel.
Uh-huh.
It was their idea.
And one of the girls asked him, what do you regret the most? And now you've heard about pain here a little bit. Okay, so they asked him, what did you regret the most? And his response was, well, you know, we had planned on a camping trip and we never got to do that.
It wasn't with me, though. It was with other people.
Yeah.
So, but, yeah.
My point is, I have a point to make with bringing this up.
Okay.
Because we could really bash him for hours here.
I don't want to do that.
And that's not the point, because
I've asked God to take him to heaven. I can't do that.
Because his story, and this is the point I want to make, is each of our story. That capacity to have that kind of an attitude is in all of us. You know, just as Scripture, you know, the story of the Israelites, we can apply that to our lives. We can apply it to humankind, the journey that we're all on as humans, you know. We can also apply each other's stories to each other, because we're all children of God. We're all made in God's image. The things that each of us experiences are things that we're all capable of experiencing. And that's why contraception kills, that's one of the main reasons why contraception kills marriages. It's the pill, aesthetics. I talked about aesthetics, the science, and the morals. The aesthetics of the pill are ugly. Okay? It's all about rejecting children. All right?
And you know, if you don't mind me saying this, when I compare the two marriages, I compare this marriage to that marriage, and I think about, wow. You know, in that marriage, there were a lot of times when I thought, you know, I really had to work, or, I mean, the effort was much greater. And with Rick, that effort isn't that hard. I mean, because we have that communication and we have that commitment to marriage, because we work together on the issues of family planning, and it's just, I'm a testimony. It's so, so much different. And I'm sure many of you guys out there have your own stories to share.
The reason it's different, I have a theory on this.
I'll bet you do.
the theory I have on this is that, simply put, I understand the language of love.
Sure.
It's true. It's true. When I was like 14
years
old.
Is that in the script?
It is, right here. Not that I boast. No, that's not true. But the fact of the matter is, when I was 14 years old, I was watching an old Arabian Nights movie. I don't know if it was Sinbad the Sailor or what it was, but it was one of those old, you know.
Oh, this is one of your pickup lines for me.
Yes,
go ahead.
Yes.
Yeah.
This whole desert movie thing, you know, and I'm watching it, and there's the good guys and the bad guys, and they're fighting, and finally the good guys win, and then they're in the tent with the women. And one of the secondary guys, the goofy guy, you know how the main guy always has a goofy guy that hangs out with him, is trying to pick up a girl. And he comes up to me and says, ah, my mountain of many delights. She was a large girl. He says, my mountain of many delights. Let us retire to some quiet spot where I will amaze you with tales of my greatness.
And I still went out with him.
I used that line for 25 years. I thought it was a great line, but the fact of the matter is, this is what's cool, is that's exactly the same language God uses with us, with His church.
Yeah.
All right, on our brochures, and I would invite you to take a brochure, because frankly, it talks about Jenny's old job, so we need to get rid of them.
But it's contact information, so you can get a hold of us.
But we put this reading on our brochures because it's so key to this issue that we're talking about today. It's from Hosea. And actually, it starts off with God talking to the Israelites, and He's saying, come with me to the desert. Okay? You know it's the language of love immediately. Then you skip a few verses, and it comes to this. I will espouse you to me forever. I will espouse you in right, in justice, in love, and in mercy. I will espouse you in fidelity, and you will know the Lord. Now, let me go back through that. You know, I will espouse you to me forever. This is it. Okay, this is our God talking to us. It's forever. I will espouse you in right. We're going to do it the right way. All right, the pill gets in the way of marriages being done right. All right, God's not going to allow that to happen in our relationship with Him. I will espouse you in right. I will espouse you in justice. That means that everything you deserve. I'm going to cry. Everything that we deserve, God is going to make sure we get. Okay, that's justice. Then he's going to espouse us in love. All that I am, all that I have is yours. Okay? He's going to espouse us in mercy. All will be forgiven. That's kind of where we started. We have to keep that in mind. All will be forgiven. And then this gets separated out. Then he comes back and he says, I will espouse you in fidelity. I said it. I mean it. It's going to happen. Take it to the bank. You know, that's our God. And he says, because of that, because of the way we do this, we'll do it rightly. We'll give ourselves to each other completely. He says, you will know the Lord. You'll know what this is all about. You'll have the answers that you want. I think that's such a powerful statement of who our God is, and it's all about marriage. Everything he says in there is our guide to happy marriages. It's our guide to knowing who he is and what our relationship is with him. Anyway, so where do we stand today? Okay, we're post-fall. We haven't realized the complete salvation yet. You know, things are still a bit of a mess, obviously, or we wouldn't be here today. You know, this is kind of this whole series kind of reminded me of Ralph Nader, to be honest with you. You know, Ralph Nader went after the automobile industry, didn't he? You know, and he wrote the book Unsafe at Any Speed about the Chevrolet Corvair. Anybody ever own a Corvair? Okay. How did you feel when you found out, after driving it for 50,000 miles, that it was the most unsafe car in the history of the world?
Well, it's really my mother's car.
Okay.
So I really didn't think about it, but it probably would have bothered me if I was still.
Absolutely. You know, the engine was in the back. If you're in a wreck, you run into anything, the engine's going to go right through you to the front of the car. The windshield popped out. If you had an accident, you'd go flying through the windshield. The gas tank would blow up. I mean, everything about that car was a mess. So he wrote this thing, Unsafe at Any Speed. And in a way, that's kind of what we're doing with this series of seminars, is we're taking a hard look at what's wrong with the world. Okay? But that can't be where this stops. Okay? We also have to get into, so what do we do about it? What does the world need? Where are we going with this? And so as we look at our world today, I do have a joke for you.
Oh, no.
Jenny says, don't tell jokes. I says, well, I got to tell a joke. But I do have a joke. Let's lighten it up for a minute. Okay, so this married couple go into a counselor. And they go in and sit down, and the counselor says, well, what can I help you with, folks? And the wife immediately starts going on about, this guy is no good. He's a lousy father. He refuses to help around the house. I could never get him to do any work in the yard. He goes off and plays golf all the time, and I never see him around here. And it's just our marriage is a mess. And the counselor listens and listens and listens, and finally she's had it. She gets up. She walks around the desk. You're right, it's a male counselor. He gets up and walks around the desk and gives the wife a big wet kiss on the lips. And he turns to the husband and says, that's what this woman needs every single day of her life. Are you willing to do what it's going to take to save this marriage? And he says, well, you know, I can probably get her in here on Mondays through Thursdays, but I really like to play golf on Fridays. Okay? All right, so that's my joke. But frankly, think about this for a minute. Before the pill came out, what was our vision of humor with the marriage situation? It was I Love Lucy, wasn't it? And who was the ditz in that show? Was it Desi or Lucy? Lucy was always getting in trouble. She was out of control. Desi had a bit of an anger, but he always was the one that was the calming force. We correct all the problems, get everything back to normal. Those days are gone, folks. Okay, now if you look at the beer commercials and stuff, what do you see? You see the guys are all big lugs. You know, all they're interested in is their man cave. And I like man caves, don't misunderstand me. But that's all they're interested in, drinking beer, hanging out in the man cave. And it's the woman who's the solid force and the one that's taking control of everything. Now, neither one of those models are the right model, are they? Yeah, okay. So we've got to see that we're somewhere in transition from here to there. guys with big lugs are not cutting it. You know, we talked about, I'm sorry, I'm not letting you talk, but we talked about the definition of marriage. You know, well, in Iowa, we're awfully confused about that right now. I don't know if you get that in the papers. We were the first state to okay homosexual weddings, marriages. And I was actually down at the Masters Golf Tournament in South Carolina, and the paper opens up, having never heard any talk of this at all. And in the South Carolina paper, I read that Iowa has, you know, some judges had come forward and decided that that was going to be the case. We're going to have homosexual marriages. And everybody was asking me, what are you guys doing up there, you know? And we didn't have an answer. Now we're bringing you telemed abortions, okay? We're the first state in the country to offer this telemed abortion thing. And we're kind of ashamed of that.
Does anybody know what that is here? Oh my gosh.
Okay.
The rural Planned Parenthoods, they have this little office, and a girl comes in. She can make the decision spontaneously, I want an abortion. And she comes into that office, and there's no medical staff, there's no doctor. And so she gets on Skype with a doctor in a bigger city and explains, you know, he asks her a few questions, and she says, this is what I want. And he pushes a button, and the drawer opens up. And she takes her pill, or pills, whatever it is, and she goes home.
And has an abortion.
And nobody tells her, you know, that she's going to go into labor, that she's going to be in pain, that she's going to deliver a baby alone. And it is, in we have seven Planned Parenthoods in Des Moines, and we have one surgical, large surgical facility, and at least five of the other six provide that. In our big city, and then all of the rural areas, that's how women are getting their abortions now.
So anyway, so
it'll be coming here because we're their test state.
Yeah, you'll have it before long. Mm-hmm. So we've got this Ralph Nader thing going, looking at what's wrong with the world. So how do we, you know, if we don't do anything today, we need to talk about each of our calling. You know, I mentioned that each of our lives are touched by this in many different ways, but each of those encounters we share, okay? And let's talk just for a minute about calling.
One of the things that Rick has always provided to our kids when they were struggling with what to do with their life and vocation, what they want to go to college for, and when we went to seminary, there was one of the monks that was teaching us, had shown us this graph idea for picking a vocation. And I've used it, which is why I've ended up doing the work that I'm doing now. But he said, you know, take a graph, and on one side here, put all of God's greatest needs. All his needs. What are his needs?
No, your greatest needs. Oh, you're right. No, I'll be quiet. The world's greatest needs. That's the point.
The world's greatest needs. But those are God's needs, right? Okay. God's world's greatest needs. Okay, down here. And then on here, all of your loves in life. And then you take that and you match it up, and that's where your vocation is.
Yes.
That's what we did.
And I can tell you what the world needs, all right? You know?
One of the things, anyway.
You know, actually, I'm getting ahead of myself. I should go back through just real quickly. We talked about aesthetics, science, and morals. Okay, well, we know that the fall is responsible for where we're at today. You know, as the human race, we're lost. We need to be saved. Okay, Christ is that Savior. You know, when Adam and Eve became ashamed of their bodies, we lost, you know, what they're talking about is they really lost the ability to see God in each other. You know, we talk about this image that we're created in. That image got lost because instead of following, the language of love, they started using each other a little bit. They started taking advantage of each other. You know, Adam decided, well, gee, if I spend a little less time worrying about Eve, I'll have more time for myself. I can become a big lug and have a man cave, you know. Eve started thinking, well, gee, you know, I have this sexual thing that he seems really, really wanting really bad. I could probably use that, you know. And the point being, though, that they both knew. We all know we use each other a little bit here and there. So I guess the point I'd like to make at this point is I can tell you what the world needs. The world needs, first of all, to get a better understanding of human sexuality. Okay, I mean, all you got to do is watch TV for 10 minutes, and you can tell that we're a little warped in that area. We need to become better lovemakers. It's as simple as that. Until we do that, nothing else is going to work right. Until we get lovemaking correct, the life issues will never be solved. You know, obviously the key issue on all of our minds is abortion. But until we get this other issue taken care of, there will be no respect for life. All right? We also need to do better with women's health care. I mean, don't we? I mean, isn't it amazing that they can call what we're doing women's health care? You talked about it, Karen. To completely disable, shut down, destroy a perfectly healthy woman's body in the name of what? What are we doing it for? Why would you guys allow us to do that? What are you doing? You want to take care of your men, don't you? All right? Well, why are the men not taking care of the women? Okay, we're back to the big lug issue again, aren't we? You know, why are the men not taking care of the women? Okay, we're using you. And in that kind of use, rather than using your fertility to achieve great things, we're using our knowledge of that fertility to hurt you and to use you. And that becomes not use, that becomes abuse. All right? And that's what we're doing. And it's the norm in our culture. And I'll tell you what else we need. Okay? If we don't get this lovemaking thing figured out, there's a real good chance, someone else mentioned something, we're going to go the way of the dinosaurs. All right? If we don't get the woman's health care issue thing figured out, you know what we need? We need that kind of medicine to go the way of bloodletting and that sort of thing. It needs to go away. All right? And organization, what else the world needs is organizations and companies that profit from the culture of death with abortion and contraception need to go the way of the Chevy Corvair. I'll tell you, because they're unsafe at any speed. You know, there are organizations in our communities that do great things. Planned Parenthood is not one of them. Is there anything else you'd like to say, my dear?
I just was afraid you were going to say one of the big needs was golf courses. But I don't have anything else to say, but I would love to open it up and ask, does anybody have any questions for us? She asked me how I overcame the concept of the fear of getting pregnant and how I was going to deal with that with my new marriage with Rick. And to be honest with you, I've always been a very strong Catholic, so I really have always leaned that direction, you know, through prayer. But I had a fabulous man in Rick. He does know a lot about life and love, and he does a good job with it. And he made me feel really, really special about my fertility, which I'd never felt before. And he had an openness to life that I'd never seen a man have before. As it turned out, God didn't bless us with any additional children. We just have the two that I have. They're both married now, and we have two grandchildren. So I tell people I have six children, which I love to say. But it, just through prayer and his support, it's about the man's support for me.
What would you tell these women then who don't have a boyfriend or husband with those qualities, because that's why they're there to get an abortion sometimes?
Right.
He's saying he's gone.
Right.
They probably need to call Dr. Phil.
I'm actually going to be facing that quite a bit, aren't I, as our clinic opens. And I think about that all the time, because that is a huge reason why these women are so afraid and why they're going to be coming into our clinic for help. But it's going to be about them feeling empowered, because they have it inside of them. But when they walk into the clinic and they're so afraid, they don't think they have any power because he's not there. And so what our job's going to be is to help them find that power within them, to help them, and a huge resource net of resources that's going to help them through it. That's what the Crisis Pregnancy Medical Clinics is about, and that's what we're going to do.
So. You know, what you're talking about is the need for abortion, and until you eliminate the need, you're going to have abortions.
Right.
And so how do you do that? You have to look at each situation by itself and do whatever it takes.
I have to tell you a little story. Last week we were training volunteers because our staff is primarily, we have two paid staff, but everybody's volunteers. We have all of our doctors are volunteers. Our nurses are volunteers. We have one nurse manager, but everybody else is volunteer receptionist. So we had some people in for training. So we did a role play, and we used our nurse manager. And this is going to be a new thing for her because she's always been in geriatrics. So she, you know, so we sat down and did a role play with her and a patient, and a girl that came in. And the person that played the girl was probably about 70 years old. And but the cute thing about it was she was a retired psych nurse. So she knew how to play this role. And they started to talk. And we use a in our clinic, we use this decision-making tool. It's called the Ottawa decision-making tool that's used all around the country for medical reasons, medical decision-making. So we have the girls fill that out, and they come to terms with where they're at on their own. And so we walk them through that if they need it. And so they're having this discussion. And it went on. And we were so, those of us watching it, were so engrossed in what was going on, and the dialogue, they were so in character. By the time they were done, this young girl, 70 years old, who was pregnant, who had to have this abortion, thought, "I can do this." We were all crying. It's a role play, you know, but we were all crying because we could see how it works and how it came together, and it was just, it's beautiful. Any other questions?
I do. I'm a sidewalk counselor, and I get this question quite a bit because we will give them the pamphlet for NFP. And the non-Catholics will ask me, well, is that the Catholics' birth control? Mm-hmm. So I need to hear from you what. Because then another thing they'll bring up by saying, well, then if that doesn't work, because their mindset is no baby. Mm-hmm. And NFP is not 100%. Nothing really is 100% except absence. So I just need to hear from you.
From a user effectiveness rate?
Well,
wait, let me finish.
Okay.
You asked me a question. NFP is the most effective outside of castration. You know, it's more effective than the pill. It's more effective. I'm sorry.
That sounds painful.
That got cut off kind of quick. I'm sorry. Oh, that's terrible.
Did you want to be a sidewalk
counselor? No, yeah, but the point is, NFP truly is the most effective method. All right.
Definitely.
And it's not just Catholic. It's all about science. It's science. Scientists who have come forward and put the effort into understanding a woman's body rather than trying to subdue it.
And I think part of it's going to be teaching that woman the preciousness of her body, you know. Yeah, there's a godly part to it, but there's another part to it too, that her body is, you know, housing that baby and how it's working and how it's being used for that baby. And so it's important for her to learn. It's education. It's more information. It's just more and more information, and that's what we need to give these women so that they can make a more informed decision for themselves. And, you know, 9 times out of 10, when they have all that information, they choose the right direction. Because
well, I know this.
Yes. Yeah, I know you do.
Out in the streets,
right.
I can't give them a whole seminar.
Exactly.
You know. So I have seconds.
That's why I would maybe...
What's the elevator speech, huh?
Is it the Catholics' birth control?
It's the environmental. It's the green. It's about being healthy.
Okay, I like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We want to be green. We want, you know, we ride bikes and we, you know, eat the healthy foods, but then we fill our body with this poison. And it's about learning the poison compared to the healthy. And that's what I do when I talk to the Protestant girls.
Do I hear that from Catholics as well?
Yeah, I'm sure you do. Yeah.
There's a lot of misinformation out there about it, you know, and...
It's a good question, though, because that is a biggie.
Mm-hmm.
That's a biggie.
And so it's tough to fight that, but mm-hmm. but proclaim the message, whether wanted or unwanted, insist upon it.
Well, we have a client website, so you can learn about the client needs, and that's choicesclinic.com. And we have a donor website that explains a little bit more of the nitty-gritty that's separate from the other, and that's informedchoiceia.org. And it's all being new branding and redone, so it'll be changing a little bit soon, but you can still get to those and take a look. Yep.
Anything else? Yes, back there.
Well, first we go out and knock on the window of the car and invite them in and offer to order pizza, which is right across the street.
You mean you don't have a man cave?
No. Actually, our clinic in Iowa City is in the process of creating a man cave for that reason. But we don't have the space in our new clinic to do that. But and once we get them in the door, we talk to them. They fill out that same decision-making tool so that they can come to terms with where they're at and why they're there. In that situation, and we get them in there to see that ultrasound, so they can see how she's. Their men are visual people, so they can see on our 46-inch screen TV this baby moving around and the heart beating. And I tell you, those men puff up like daddy bears, like you've never seen. And once they see the beauty of this woman and what her body is doing. It comes, you know. It's not overnight. You know, we're not going to get everybody in the door and say, you know. But one of the aspects that we have going for us is our medical director is a Creighton practitioner and
NAPRO
and medical consultant for them. And so he's going to be teaching that out of our clinic, and he will be able to talk directly to these guys, and we'll make sure that he gets to do that. So.
Absolutely.
Yep, absolutely.
High percentages. I mean,
95% of those men that see that ultrasound wrap their arms around that woman and take care of them.
Just within the last month or so, it's actually suggests an ultrasound go.
Mm-hmm.
From your perspective, how good will that be?
Unbelievable.
That's huge.
Is that what is it, 88%, I think, of women who see an ultrasound of the baby choose life for it?
Closer to 90.
And
that's huge.
Texas is okay, they see the ultrasound, and then they're told to come back to the abortion clinic. 2 days later,
So they have to have 24 hours before they come back?
Right.
Okay, all right.
They don't.
Okay, yeah, that was my next question.
Yeah.
Right.
Now, as long as they're dealing with the abortion clinics, there's going to be things that don't work. You know, there's going to be things that get in the way. They're going to try and discourage. They'll poo-poo this, and
one of the things that we do to kind of draw clients in is the abortion clinics don't tell these women that if they have an STD when they get a surgical abortion that it will most likely transfer that disease up into their pelvic area and cause pelvic inflammatory disease, and they likely could become infertile, and they don't learn that, and so we present ourselves as if you are getting an abortion, make sure you don't have an STD. Come to us. We'll give you a free STD first. And then they come in, and we get to talk to them about what's going on, and we get to share the gospel with them. They're not going to hear that at Planned Parenthood. And they have to take that test, and then they have to come back for results. So it prolongs that time, too, when they can think about what's going on and what they've learned and the information that they've got from us and come back, and that helps a lot. It helps give us more face time with that girl.
What I've encountered with, people that I know, women, is that mentality of, well, why would I want to do an NFP or anything like that when I want to have sex when I want to? That whole mentality.
You know,
or I'm starting to act like men.
Exactly.
That way of thinking. And I'm just like, they just shut me off.
Well, here's the deal.
I want it when I want to.
Yeah. Here's the deal. You know, people are always, there's always going to be people that that's their attitude. We've got plenty of time. But what's important to remember, you know, when you run into a situation like that is that the quality, the aesthetics of their sexual behavior is so far less than what they're capable of. You know, John Paul talks about how, you know, if we don't experience love in our life, we become incomprehensible to ourselves. People will go anywhere for love. And as Christopher West says, you know, they'll dig in the dumpster for it. And there's nothing you can do about that other than to continue to present the facts. You know, a lot of people think of NP as a form of contraception in many ways. It's a way not to have babies. But what it really is it's gaining an understanding of your body so you can do whatever you want with it. If you want to have babies, you can have babies. If you don't want to have babies, you don't have to have babies. But what you're not doing in the process is changing sexuality into something that was never intended to be. Okay? It's not, you know, a lot of people in the world today think sexuality is a game. It's a toy. You know, I've heard that phrase used so many times. It's a toy. But it's not a toy. And there's so much more out there. And until people understand that, which is really our job. I mean, if we all leave today and go home and do nothing about this, and spread no news about this, you know, do nothing with our kids, if nothing else, then we failed. You know, the word has to get out that sexuality was designed to be beautiful. And whenever there's sexuality outside of a monogamous marriage, there's a price to be paid, all right? And it's usually paid for by the woman. And that's not right.
Our daughter is just ended 5 years teaching theology at the Catholic high school in where we live. And she has been the pro-life, Students for Life director there. And she took that organization from about 15 members to over 100 before she left. But she told me the other day, she said, whenever a girl comes to her with, you know, similar type comments, and these kids love her, so they have opened up more than you can imagine to her. She sends them to that website, the 28 Days on the Pill, and she says they come back to her changed. And so that has been a valuable tool for her to use in trying to teach them the dangers of the pill. 28 Days on the Pill, and I think it's a website you just could Google. Has anybody else seen that? No? Yeah. I haven't even seen it. But she told me about it, and she said it's really made a difference for her with those working with those kids. Anybody else?
Yes.
Do I understand correctly that you said you have a couple in, and she's pregnant, and they both see a sonogram? It affects the man more than the woman. Do I understand that correctly?
A lot of times it does, because she's had time to get used to the fact that is living inside of her, and so she's thinking about it all the time. Her body is reacting to it. She's feeling the effects of it. He isn't. That's his first visual is that baby, is that true 4D ultrasound of that baby. It's powerful. We just work very hard to get him in there, I'll tell you, because a lot of times it's the boyfriend or it's the mom who are forcing her through this, so we have to work, you know. But if we can get him in there, and sometimes even the mom, we'd want the moms to come in too, it will change them. But yeah, the men.
And that's part of this whole, you know, the clinic, of course, is free. And so the free STD testing gets people in the doors like crazy. You know, there's ways to be inviting. And once someone comes in, they are never confronted, they are never judged. Okay, if someone goes and has an abortion, they're welcome to come back anytime and do it again and go through the process. It's a completely unjudgmental situation.
They have so much information when they leave our clinic on what abortion is, all the different kinds, how it works. We show them visually how it works. We have models. We have movies. We talk to them about everything, and it's very clinical what we talk to them about, very clinical, so they know how it works. And then we show them their pregnancy. It's very clinical again. You know, we show them how their body works and by the time they leave, that's why our name is so perfect, Informed Choices Medical Clinic, because they leave with so much information that they can make a much, much better decision for themselves.
Yes. Well, as part of
before that the pill changes chemically the attraction that the woman
yep.
has. And that wasn't talked about a lot, but that also is yep. a factor in killing the marriage.
Yes.
The woman is on it. She no longer wants to give.
Exactly.
I mean, it really deadens the...
It does.
...their attraction to the man, so the man doesn't get it, and mm-hmm. then they go looking.
And it also mm-hmm. affects...
Yep. Good point.
It also affects who they choose as their mate. Quite often, they'll choose someone who really shouldn't be their mate. They'll choose for the wrong reasons. They'll choose without the right feelings.
Do you have any information on once the woman gets off the pill, if that ever bounces, if that ever goes back to normal?
I don't know.
You mean the...
the attraction
the
woman's
thing. On the pill, and then she stops taking it.
Do you mean, like, statistically,
like,
you know,
they,
information? You know, I don't know the scientific side to that degree, but I can only assume. I mean, when you think about the level of hormones that are going through her body and affecting her pituitary gland, which is a pretty powerful gland, and then you clean and cleanse your body of that just like any other cleansing.
You know, it's probably like everything else that has to do with the pill. Sometimes you're fine, sometimes you're not. We've met a lot of infertile people.
Well, if it's making your body think it's pregnant, then you're suppressing your libido, and that's why you're not feeling the attraction. And you get off of that, your body is back to normal. Your libido is then back to normal. And
so there's a good chance, yes, is what she's saying. To make a long story short.
I'm not a doctor. I wish my doctor was here.
Yeah. Anything else? Yes.
I'll suggest the research by Dr. Janet Smith.
Yep.
Yeah.
Contraception, why not?
Sure.
Everybody
very great that. Idea.
Yep.
Yep.
There's a ton of scientific research on this.
Yep.
I think I see Father McCaffrey has some CDs here.
Yeah,
is that what that is?
I have that. Well, I have one of them, but I do have that CD, and I'll have it available here.
Okay.
All right.
Some of them, anyway.
Well, one last thing here, too. We do parish missions. Okay, we do retreats. Grab one of our brochures from the table. It has her at her old job. But other than that, it's you know, please feel free to invite us. If you would like to hear this kind of stuff preached from your pulpit, it can be done. Just give us a call. Or Father McCaffrey.
One more question here.
Yes.
Well, the best approach has got to come from you, the parishioners, and not just that one same old parishioner that's always coming to him, you know, and saying, you really shouldn't have said this, or you really should do this, or why don't we... But you know, you need to rally your troops, and you need to have a game plan, I think, and you need to talk to him, and you need to tell him that your people, these are your people, are suffering, and you can't get to all of them, but he can. Or he can bring us in, and then he doesn't have to feel funny about it, which is a really good idea, because it is hard. It's hard for us to even go into our parishes in our local area, you know, because people know us, and it's like preaching to your family, you know. But we can come in. We can take that pressure off of him. Father Dan can come in, take that pressure off of him.
And we're really cheap.
And it's his job to do that.
Mm-hmm. Which is a little embarrassing.
Sure.
But not for them, only for us, because they are so open to hearing about it. And when we took that to our pastor,
perfect testimony.
Very interested in mm-hmm. all of our non-Christians.
Mm-hmm.
I've heard Father McCaffrey talk about the pain that are in all of our parishes, the marriage struggles that are there, and how pastors are looking. I mean, when you approach it from the fact that the pill kills marriages, you have an answer for that. You can help them out, you know.
Any other questions?
Thank you. There's one back there.
Okay.
Sorry.
Oh, no.
Okay.
Well, I just want to follow up on a great pastoral resource. The Pope Paul VI Institute mm-hmm. started putting out a newsletter for pastors, I think, on a monthly basis. Help educate them on basic medical knowledge related to family planning and how to communicate to their congregation.
Okay, for those of you that are watching this and didn't hear that, she said the Pope Paul VI Institute, Dr. Hilger's organization, has put out a newsletter for pastors and priests, and they can sign up on the website, and that's a great resource. Thank you very much.
And we'd be remiss not to mention the couple to couple, too, who does clergy seminars all the time and that sort of thing. So.
Did you have one more?
I was just going to mention that our Bible counselor, Rebecca, stated that her Anglican pastor, Father David Allen, made the comment that we will never teach our young people to appreciate the sacredness of life until we teach them to appreciate or understand the concept of sacred.
Good point.
That seemed to be very profound to me.
Yeah.
Very profound.
That's beautiful.
I can repeat it. The listening audience.
The listening audience.
Yeah.
She had just said that one of the Anglican priests had made a comment that we're not going to be able to change the hearts and teach people the sacredness of life until we teach them what sacred is and what it means. And so that's another angle that we can all take out into our community and
I'll use
and
it.
Expand on. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, you guys.
Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you.